Dear students, welcome to the knowledge series. Here under the course EC407, Computer Communication, we are going to discuss the network devices, virtual line, and its relevant study areas. So let's see the network layer or the network access layer. You have already studied about TCP/IP model. The TCP/IP model was developed prior to the OSI model. However, the TCP/IP model is not exactly the way the OSI model is being represented. The TCP/IP model consists of four layers. In certain cases, it says, or it has been shown as a five layer. That is the application layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and the physical layer. Of course, these two are merged together, so that's how you see four layers. So if you try to see the first four layer, it provides the physical standard, network interface, interworking, and transport functions. This is the main and major components. I repeat again, the physical standards, the network interface, the interworking and transport layer functions. These four components that corresponds to the first four layer of the OSI model, and these four are also represented under the TCP/IP layers model. This plays a very major roles, followed by the applications layer. So the TCP/IP is basically a hierarchical protocol that is made for interactive models, and each of them has and provide a specific functionality, so that you are aware about it. So now we will be seeing the one section that is the network. We have been talking about this one in our previous series of the video that has been shared, has been discussed with respect to the network layer. So network layer is the second layer if you look from the TCP/IP model. And the network layer, it combines also the other two components, that is the other two layers, that is the data link layer and the physical layers. Now if you look across the functionality of a network layer, it tries to encapsulate the IP datagrams into frames and transmitted and it transmits by the network by mapping its IP address, that is the logical address that you have understand. So it maps the IP address, that is a logical address, into physical address, that is in the data link layer. So the protocols of the network layer, if you try to see carefully, it has some of the other segments like ICMP, IGMP, ARP, RARP. So our this series of discussion is with respect to these individual functional components that you see in the network layer. And when you see this IP is the internet protocol, so that is the internet layer also we termed it as in the TCP/IP. Certain cases you will find that the TCP/IP in place of network, it will term as a internet layer. And this layer is basically, as for the TCP/IP, is a second layer, because these two are merged together, so this becomes the second layer. And this internet layer is also known as network layer. The main responsibility of this internet layer is to send a packet. So that is what you can see, this internet layer is to send the packet from the any network. So when you say any network, means if you are running from the top layer, that is application transport, and it comes to the network layer, and it sends through the data link layer and the physical layer, that is being shown as here. This is your data link layer, and the next is coming the physical layer, and through this it will send to the destinations. So you can try to see this one. The IP address is being generated in the network layer, that is mapping with respect to the destination IP, and destination IP is also verifying the MAC address from this sending side. It is the one who has sent that one. So here it is looking for the destination, here it is looking for which sender has sent. So the physical logical layer is being mapped into physical layer, or nothing but a MAC address. So that is what you can see. So here the frame is the data message, where you have a IP header, that is this header will be there, and a TCP header, which is from the transport layer, okay, for making a proper connectivities or forming a proper network link. So that is one which is being shifted to the data come physical layer. So through the Ethernet or through the wireless, you can transport to the destinations, and at the destination it follows the this sequence. So this is what we try to see. So we will study about these components here in this sections. So in our next sections, we will be talking a brief about our IPv6, that is a classless inter-domain routing. Now in the classless inter-domain routing, basically this was developed in the year 1990 for performing a standard routing network traffics for the future internets. Future, when you say future, means the current is also included, but because of the current usage of IPv4, that's why I have used this particular terms. So before the development of this CIDR, that is a classless inter-domain routing, so that is one network to the another another network, the internet managed with the IPv4 was finding a difficulties, because the value of IPs that determines the routing was not sufficient enough. So that's why it was developed based on the classless or a CIDR form of routing mechanisms. So CIDR is basically the alternate of the IP subnetting. We have studied what is in by IP, we have studied what is in by subnetting. In the subnetting, we try to divide the network into smaller forms. So the IP address, basically we try to see that in place of a class, we try to do a classless form of a subnetting, so that it becomes an easy form of distributing to a larger number. So if you try to see this one, this is a decimal form of a representation. It's binary representation that is being shown over here, and if you are considering only this much sections as a network ID, then you consider the next sections as a automation research center ID, then you consider the another ARS, that is a public research server, as a another extension. Like that, you distribute the classless form of a distribution. In place of class, we are doing class A means this one, class B means this one, class C means this one, then class D and class E is like this. But in the classless, what we try to, we implement with the support of a certain configuration, like a MCI, Automation Research Center, ARS, public servers, servers, and like that we define, so that this here we will not put the classless. And CIDR is the successor of the class-oriented domain for the internet routing, because it allows a better allocations of internet addresses, because there is a form with respect to a certain group wise. And it combines the number of sections, and thereby it tries to reduce the burden of the routing tables. So that is what we try to see in the case of a classless routing. And this type of routing methods, it is more efficient way, and that reduce the issues of wastage of address space in the routers. So we will be able to use the router in an efficient way. If we put a class B, only a certain address is used and certain address is wasted. Instead of that, we try to demark it based on the requirements. So if this one is lesser utilized, this will try to occupy that one. If this is lesser used, this will be occupied by this. If this is lesser used, then it is used for the further research or another set of activities based on the based on the distributions of the CIR under the classless of IPv6 configurations also. And this is being shown with respect to the IPv4. So the class has become classless inter-domain routing. So now we go to the next sections with respect to the network layer basic functional blocks. Now you can see here it is being stated as address resolutions protocols, or we say ARP. So ARP is a protocol that is used to obtain the node's physical address. That means by using this one, we are going to find the physical address. Physical address is nothing but a MAC address. So here this is a client, a router is there. Router is broadcasting to the client. So stations. So ARP request is being sent over the network with the IP address. So with that IP address, when it is sending, it is mentioning that I am looking for a MAC address and I want to communicate with that devices. So with that address is sent over the network. So in this network, when it is sending, so it is sending this, I am looking for a physical address of a node whose IP address is 141.235.623. I take an example to analogy of this one is that, assume that in your house 5 members are there. So every 5 members will be having five members will be having its own name. So let us think that your neighbor want to communicate with your mother. So from the neighbor, either neighbor will be saying in terms of a name. Then if the neighbor is talking, is using a voice to voice towards your house and calling with the name, automatically the concern will try to come out and try to say hello and discuss with him. So with him or her, that is a point of a simple discussions with respect to a neighbor directly interacting with, indirectly interacting with your house members. So that is one case. The another case is that neighbor do not know anybody in your, but knows the name that I am looking for so and so. So automatically from by listening that one, the concern will be coming out and showing the presence in the outside. So this is what we see in the network also. The router is sending a request, that is a ARP request on the network line, and stating that this network line is nothing but your house, think like that, where every members are there. So in that house, the name over the one who is having that particular IP address, that IP address will be accessed by the device, and the device will be able to respond back. So ARP request is basically on based on the IP address to the target nodes, and that is to communicate, and the node with that address will try to respond back with its physical address, so that after the receive of that physical address, the information in the form of a packet is being transmitted. And ARP returns the layer 2 address for a layer 3 address. So this is a layer 2, that is a MAC. Here is a layer 3, that is a logical address. So this is a physical address and this is a logical address. So this is what we see in the case of ARP. That means ARP, in a one word, it tries to map the internet protocol address to a MAC address by using a ARP request to access the concern the actual intended devices. And once the intended device receive that request, based on the ARP request, the physical address, you can see the physical address has been shown in this way, and the MAC IP address has been shown in this way. So here this is a 48 and this is a 32. So you find that based on that, it is being sent over the response back. This is a request, this is a response back from the client to the host. So this is what we try to see between the ARP request from the host to the client, and from the client to the host. Now we go to the next slide. Now here you have to understand, when we talk about this ARP request, how it is, what is there in that request? See, it is not like a switch, on-off switch. Rather, it is having a set of bits are there. That is what we termed as a packet frame. So when we see the packet, it packet has a packet appearance is something in a dynamic way or in a static way. Dynamic way means in this entry is created automatically when a sender broadcast its message to the network, and dynamic entries are not permanent. Every time it will keep on changing. But static entry means the sender will enter the IP address to the MAC address, and by using a ARP request. That means that is a static, that is a fixed. But dynamic case means it is keep on changing. What does it mean? You are not using a mobile for only one purpose. You are using a multiple purpose. So automatically, your mobile is communicating with the multiple network using a multiple IP, not for a fixed activities. So if you look across this particular packet, it has it is having a several sections, starting from hardware device protocol type, hardware length, protocol length, operation request and reply, sender hardware access, sender protocol address, target hardware access, and target protocol address. That means this is a host and this is a client section. Now, what exactly this hardware type? Basically, it defines the type of the network in on which this ARP is running, and that hardware type is basically a 16 bits or a 2-byte size. That is the hardware type that is being used for the ARP. Now the next is a protocol type. Basically, this is defines which type of a protocol it is being used. whether IPv4 or IPv6. So this is for a IPv4 protocol. The next is a hardware length. Basically, this protocol type is a 2-byte. Now coming to the hardware length, this is a 1-byte frame. So in this 1-byte or 8-bit field, it defines the length of the MAC address. Okay, this is the MAC address of the particular hardware, because sender's MAC address. And the protocol length for this one is a 8-bit long IP address is being used with respect to this protocol length. Now coming to the operations, when you talk about an operation ARP request, there are two operations. Is that request is there and the response or a reply. So that is what we see here, and this is also a 2-byte, the 1-byte and 1-byte each. Now another is a sender hardware access. The sender hardware access, basically in this field, the MAC address is there, or a MAC address or a hardware address of the sender is being shown, and this field is a of a variable length. So that is what we see in the case of a sender hardware. And the sender protocol is basically the IP address. Okay, the target hardware is the MAC address, and target protocol is nothing but the IP address. Now as you have seen the ARP packet, this packet in a broader way, if you want to see, it is like this one. See, this is a packet, okay, this is a packet total, on which this ARP request only is this much. See, this is the ARP request. So this ARP request, when you are sending, how you are sending? In this way, ARP request. So this ARP request is this one, but it need to form you cannot send this one. So you have to create in the form of a packet and send. So that packet, complete packet, is like this one. You remember the packet source address is there, from where it is sending. Destination address is there, where it is sending, and the type, and here is a padding and the CRC. So that is what we try to see in the case of a ARP request. Basically, if you just a packet is you are sending, here this is called as a data set, or that is what we see the data here. So but here the data is in the form of ARP request is being sent. That you clearly under, when you see this one, what is that one? Think that this is a packet. This section is being modified, whether it is for sending only data or only a handshaking message, like a request or a response, that is being put across this. Now we go to the next area, is nothing but a RARP. RARP is the opposite of a ARP, that is reverse address resolutions protocols. Now ARP request is to retrieve the physical address from the destinations using a logical IP. That is you are knowing. That means client is host is retrieving the MAC address from the receiver using the logical IP. Whereas this RARP protocol, when you put as a reverse RARP, that protocols is basically do the reverse process. But when you see the RARP protocols, it is now basically an obsolete one, because these protocols has been replaced by some of the protocols such as bootstrap protocols, that is BOOTSP, and a dynamic host configurations protocol, that is DHCP. That has changed the reverse ARP protocols. But if you look at the reverse ARP protocols, what you see from the in this one is that, no, if the host want to know the IP address, so what exactly, no, it will try to broadcast the RARP query packets frame that contains the physical address of the entire network. So this physical RARP will serve as a network recognitions packet, and it will try to look for the host for the server. So this from the device A, it is looking for the devices. So this device C, it has found that RARP. Immediately getting this RARP, this request is being returned back to the device A. So that is what we see. But the message format of the RAR protocol, if you try to see, it is almost all similar to ARP. But RARP, when it is sending this particular packet, that is by encapsulating the data positions of the frame, the two protocol is little different. Now ARP use the value 1 to request to value 2. So if I am putting this one in terms of or A to B, that means this is sending a request to here, but at the same time, if you see that when this is requesting, sometime you will find that this device is responding, this device is responding, and this may be receiving. So this is responding, this may be receiving. So this is what happens. RARP on the other hand use the 3 and 4, that means B and D scenario. So this is what we see in the case of RARP case, that is a reverse case. So here is a reverse case, that is what we know, just like even in the ARP is also there, but others are also coming into picture. So like ARP frame, the two protocol are, though it appears thus to be the same, it is different in the operational case, because ARP case the request will be there and the second is respond back. But in the RARP uses the both 3 and 4, that is C and B and D also to respond. So that is not basically, it will try to create a collisions in this particular case. So that is what we see in the case of a RARP packet case. Here also you see like this one, hardware protocol, hardware address space, protocol address space, hardware address length, protocol length, opcode, then source hardware and protocol, target hardware and protocols with the definite. So here is what is my address, IP address is this one. But when it is responding, you can see the others is also responding. So there is it is looking for a reverse addressing protocol. The stress is more on the reverse. So everybody will try to respond in this case with respect to RARP. So here this is a RARP server. You can try to see. That means if the any device want to know what is the IP address of that device, this RARP too. So whereas in the ARP, what is that? ARP look for the MAC address. RARP look for the IP address. So that is how you should distinguish between the simple. So RARP basically is defined with respect to the search of the IP address. So that is very important summary of this RARP case. Now we go to the next sections with respect to the ICMP. What exactly this ICMP indicate? ICMP stands for Internet Control Message Protocols. So whatever message we are communicating, how it has to be controlled. So when you see about a control, you should remember that we have studied data control, data error corrections. So those areas, when you try to try to surf your mind, you will be able to, or brain, you can able to understand we are talking about some of the error corrections code. So the as you can see, the ICMP, the acronyms of the ICMP is basically the Internet Control Message Protocols, and this is coming under the network layer. And the ICMP is used for by the host and the router to send the notification of a IP datagrams, that is the Internet Protocol datagram problem back to the senders. So that is what we see. When that means you have sent a IP request, and that IP request is being varied, or it has been or on that IP packet some data has been changed because of the bit collision or a bit variations. So those will create a error, thereby it will try to interact with the network to find that where that particular problem resides. So the IP network device sends the ICMP request. So if you try to see the this particular frame, it is having an IP header, Ethernet header, that is a MAC. So ICMP header is shown. This is a data where you can see the type of the ICMP, the code section that is been shown with respect to the ICMP case. Third is nothing but the checksum. Fourth and the next bit is unused, and there the data resides. This is 8-bit, this is 8-bit, 16-bit, the total here it comes as 32. So that is how the ICMP is being defined. This type of questions comes ICMP, ARP, all whenever you study this one, this packet you should study, because this is important questions where you have to draw these packets and you have to explain the about this packet. So here in the ICMP, as you can see the first field, what you try to see, the it tries to manage the packets. And the second field, it tries to see whether the network or the host type. And the third field ensure the checksum. So that is what we try to see in the case of a ICMP. Now ICMP files structure depends upon the type of the files, the type of the sources that is being transmitting the packet over the network. So ICMP is considered to be a crucials in the IP network with respect to the frame structures. So here the protocol is being used followed like a ping to see that whether that particular packet has been received by the source to destination, or the source to destination, or the is being having a link connectivity or a network connectivity or not. So ICMP protocol handles different type of error. You can see that different errors like a destination unreachable. That means if the packet is not reaching to the destination, so this type of a error is being report is generated. Source quench. That means it is for the congestion controls. When the message is sent, message is sent, the congested router to the source host, it tries to see that there is no transmissions network rate downfall. That means there should not be a traffic congestions, so that the data can be sent and receive at an appropriate rate. Time exceeded. That means a packet is sent and within a given time frame it has not received the acknowledgement, so thereby it is discarded. Parameters problems. That means a problem with respect to the IP and its parameters. So that need to be analyzed. Redirection. Redirections means and the, there will be a several routing tables will be there, and datagrams need to forward based on the routing table the packet to the various destinations. So that is nothing but a redirections. That means the packet routing, if a router is having a table, so from where it is coming and where it has to go, all these things based on the routing table, that decision has to create, and thereby it should transmit the packet. So that is what we see in the case of a ICMP. Now we go to the next, is nothing but a IGMP. IGMP start with in the acronym of IGMP is nothing but Internet Group. G stands for Group Message Protocols. So IGMP is again a TCP/IP family of network layer, and it was developed in the year 1989 at Stanford University, and it is having RFC 1112. That is a request for corrections. That is the IGMP's outline it shows. And this protocol, and it allows the host to advertise its multicast groups. That means every host can look for the groups in a network or a neighboring groups. Through the switches or through the routers. And basically IGMP, the group name G itself is a group, so you can get an idea that it talks about a network to network. So whether it is a inter-network or a intra-network, that is a outside or inside, IGMP use the router and the switches. And IGMP is used by the host and router to identify the host in another network through a LAN or a wireless LAN configurations. And basically it is used for a wide area network, wide area multicast routing. So in this case, if the host is having a membership, then the process running at the host will form a member of the group. And when a router is having a membership, then the group of the network connected to router become a member of the group. So one side it express the host member group, another side is it talks about the router member group. Now if you see across the format of IGMP message, you can see that there is IP header is the 20 byte, IGMP of 8 bytes. So the IGMP is encapsulated within a IP address. So that is what we see in this case. Now if you look across the IGMP further, it is showing a type, it is having a maximum response time, and it is having a check. Type means it determines the message type, like a message query or a message report or a leave report. Those things it talks about. That means with respect to the type of a message, with respect to the membership query, whether it is a host or a router, whether it is having a packet is being leaving a particular notes, all this information is being coming under these types. Another is the maximum response times. That means sending a report or sending a query message, what is the response time? So that is under the 8-bit frame structure it is being designed. Checksum. It tries to look across the payload, that is the data in the IPgrams. Is there any error based on the checksum methods? The group, when you talk about a group address, there are different form of a groups. One is for a membership query. Membership query means, in this case, group address is set to 0. And the general query is set for the, means a host is sending a query to the various group with respect to the members, a membership, so that it can form a network. Membership report means a group address, in this case, is set by the only within the member, so that the member to member routing informations. Leave report, it is basically a multicast group addresses. So that is what we see in the case with respect to the IGMP. Now we go to the next area of discussions is on virtual LAN. LAN is a local area network. So virtual LAN is a logical subnet sub-network where a collections of various other devices are physically connected to the LAN. So that is known as in the case of a physical LAN. But in the virtual LAN, what we do is that in place of physical, we do a wireless methods, thereby the devices can be connected to the another devices through a particular switch, ad hoc switch, or a switch related to the virtual LAN, which is a hardware software device. Now virtual LAN try to improve the performance of a network by using by a network switch in an efficient way. So virtual LAN also brings a security benefits of a large network because it tries to have a greater control of the device that is being accessed locally. So if you look in your home, you are having a modem, and if you are having a mobile phone or you are having a laptop, you can use the Wi-Fi system and you can virtually connect to the systems. The advantage of the virtual LAN, if you try to see that, no, it can broadcast to a certain distance and with the certain available bandwidth. And it has a, since it can restrict data using a sufficient amount of a password, so that security can also be maintained in this case. And for a large virtual LAN, we can go for subrouting or we can go for a segment form of a smaller virtual LAN, so that by using a router, we can try to reduce the cost. Because we should not have one big device to connect a thousand. Rather, we will try to create a router, and from the router we try to distribute, so that the major cost will be also reduced, and the major breakdown, because it just like a centralized form of a breakdown, can be avoided. And in this case, it is the physical area is very transparent. Now, if you look across the disadvantage part. Because there are so many devices, so many routers will be there, so it is complex to handle. And you need a more configurations. You have to do a IP address with subnetting, and thereby configuration everything. It is going to increase the maintenance and the overhead. So this is what we try to see. And if you look across the application of a virtual LAN, it is basically used everywhere, like in an ATM, asynchronous transfer mode, Ethernet, and in the fiber optical, like a fiber distributed data interface, we try to use these particular conditions. So up to 200 kilometer, this particular devices is being used. Coming to the next point of discussions, it is with respect to the various devices and the types. Now, if you look across the devices types, what is the devices and the types? It indicates, because we have been talking about the IP address, we have been talking about packet transfer from one point to others. All these things is taking place through a software and a hardware. So these devices is basically used for communications between the various hardwares used in the computer network. So that is what we termed it as a network devices. So these devices is either may be in the physical forms or it may be a network hardware or maybe a network equipments form and it these devices are communicate interface with the computer systems or a computer networking devices. So network, when you use these devices, we can connect to a various components. What are those components? Like a computer, fax, printers, mobiles, all these devices or IoT devices, all these things you can able to connect through this particular network devices. So these devices has a specific features, and it has a certain properties over which the development is designed. So let's see some of the devices. Now let's start with the network hub. So if you see the network hub, it's a device. You can see a small port is there, dots are there. So through this port you can connect the number of cables or Ethernet cables, so that your device, if a computer want to send data to another computer, so through this hub it can able to transmit. But when the data comes in the case of a hub, every data appears here at the other end also in an equal manner. But those devices which is desired to accept, it is going to receive. That means it is just like you are having a connectors, say like a 1:2 or a 2:1 or 3:1 connector, or like a TV connector. You connect your cable and another at the other end you connect number of TVs, you can able to see the signals at the same instant. That is the like a hub, and basically it is for data processing. So you will find the at the each port equal set of data you can able to see. Data can be transferred from the one point to the another point at the same instance. So that is what we see in the case of a hub. And these hubs are two type. One is an active hub and another is a passive hub. Now, active hub and passive hub, what is the difference is that in the case of an active hub, it tries to transmit for a short distance. Maximum, it will not go for a long distance. But the passive, it is suitable for the long distance, and you can further keep on adding. But in the case of a passive hub, you cannot go for increasing the size because of its limitations. And if you extend it, it will deteriorate the signal signal characteristics, and thereby the data may get affected, or error may try to erupt. The next, you can see the switches. The switches is exactly one more point I want to say is that hub case, whenever the data is you are sending to the hub, this hub is not intelligent. Whatever data you are inserting at the port, those data is being seen at the every other port. So it will try, it is as if it is rebroadcasting the data to every hub point. So A want to send to B, and C and D is connected. So the same data is appeared at the A, C, D. So the one which is desired, that device, not only the intended device, other devices will also access the data. So that is the shortfall in the case of a hub, because it is not intelligent. Whereas when you try to see the switch is having an intelligent as compared to the hub. So when you send the data, switch will try to see from which IP it is coming, where it has to go. So it will be routing to that point. So that is based on the truth table it will try to maintain, and it will try to see that how that particular destinations of the particular packet is being routed properly. So that is what you see the hub and switch. Hub and switch, the both are used in the LAN, but they are not able to exchange data for the outside network. That is what you try to see. But for the internal purpose, hub and switch is suitable. But if you want to use for the external, then you have to go with the router. Actually, a router is used for forwarding the data, and this is basically used for the IP addresses. So that's why for the external network you use a router, and router, what it does in at each port, it will receive the packet, and if the packet is necessary for the device where which is connected to this router, it will send. Otherwise, it will reject and send that packet to the other destinations. So that is what we see in the case of a router. The basic difference between hub and switch with respect to router is that hub and switch is basically used to create a network, but router is basically used to connect a network. So you understand, this is creating a network, but this is for connecting a network. And of course, switch is also connecting a network. Now we see the another one is a modem. So that is what the another modem is, nothing but a modulation, signal modulation and a demodulation. In our home, there is a everybody is having a modem. When you are connecting to say BSNL, then you will be having a modem, or any other network, you will be having a modem. So whenever a telephone line, you are connecting to a telephone line generates an analog signals. So you have to the modem, what it does, it will try to convert that one into a digital forms, and thereby it will try to do internet connectivities. That's how the modulation, and in the demodulation, the reverse process will take place. So the internet connection to the home through the wire, it is a digital or in a binary data in the form of a 1 and 0, and thereby the modem will try to do the conversions according to the modulating conditions or a demodulating conditions. So that is what we use for the modem, for using a link that will enable this packet to route. Another is a network router. I have spoken the bridge. Bridge is basically, it operates in the data link layer. Now, and one more point, the router, it operates in the network layer. Switches, it operates in the data link layer and in the network layer. Hub is operating in the data link layer. Similarly, the bridge is operating in the data link. So here, the computer network bridge, it tries to unites number of network devices. So the main function of the bridge is to here, in place of a devices, what we do in the hub and switch, here bridge is used not to connect the device, but rather the network. So you can interconnect the several set of a network, and transmit basically the bridge use the MAC address for transmitting the frame. And this is used for connecting a two physical local area network, so that a large local area network can be formed. And further, in the OSI model, the bridge work at the data link layer and the physical layers, and thereby it makes the connectivity between the sender to the receiver. Next is a repeater. The repeater basically operates in the physical layer. And the main function of the repeater is where it is used for producing a signal which is similar to the network layer. If the signal is weak, then it will try to boost that particular signal, so that once the actual strength is achieved, then it will again forward that particular signals. So this is what we see in the case of a repeater. Gateway. Gateway is basically performs for the sessional layer and transport layers of the OSI model, and it is used for converting the network OSI technology and the TCP IP technology. It's a gateway. Gateway, you can understand that when you are connecting from one network to the another, so the gateway sections, how you use that particular packet for passing through the network, through the route, how it has to take the routing conditions, all this thing is coming under this particular gateway. So the gateway need a special network administrations and the policies, because from here the different network are being connected, so the routing, everything has to be processing is getting processed through this particular gateway. Of course, router and the gateway both are integrated in a, when you are connecting in a networks, which is a internetworks or a outside networks. There is one more device is called as a router. Router is also called as a bridge, like a it's not a router but a bridging router, and its main function is that it combines both the router and the bridges together. So and it performs in the network layer or a data link layers. And moreover, when it is working like a router, it is for routing the packet. And whenever it working like a bridges, it is used for filtering the LAN traffic. So these are what we see in the case of a network devices. Now another is the as I have talked about the different things about the sub switches and router. So this is what you can see in the hub switches and router. In this case, you can try to see that this PC is sending a packet. This packet, when it comes to hub, that same packet is reaches to another two devices. One is to the printer, another to the laptop. I assume that this is one to print. So instead of sending to the printer only, the same packet goes to laptop also. So that is known as hub. So here there is no security protection. So in place of intended receiver, other is also receiving. Whereas in the case of a switch, when this PC is sending, it will be exactly routed to the printer based on the IP. So that is what we try to see, or based on the MAC, it will be able to receive. In case of a router, we can see that the inside the network, the router is being used, and this now router is sent to the external world router, and from external world router again, it is going to the another router of the another network. So assume that this is a wireless, this is a net, this is an internet where this particular router is close to the server in the internet proxy situation, or in the internet domain, the server which is being used for transmitting the IPs informations. That this is a remote router. So this network router is interacting with the router and remote router, and there will be a gateway will be there. From there, similarly, there will be another gateway with the remote router to the next network. That's how the routing mechanism will take place. So this is these two are internals, and this is a external form of a network device. If you look across the comparison between the hub switches and router, this is very important. If you look across a layer, hub is a physical layer. This is a data link layer and a network layer. And this, if you talk about a TCP/IP layer, then these two are put together. If you talk from the OSI layer, this is a physical layer. This is a switch layer. This is a data link layer, and this is a network layer. If you look about the functionality, this is for connecting as a one-to-one device. But if a multiple device is there, then it is better to have a switches. So that is what we see in the case of a virtual LAN scenarios. And this one is for direct data in the network, because it is based on the IP connectivities. Data transmission forms, electrical signal and bits, here frames and packets. Here in the router, it is basically packets. Port, it is 4 to 12 ports will be there. Here 4 to 48 ports will be there. Here it comes around 2 port, 4 port, 5 ports and 8 ports, like you can, if you have seen in the device. Transmission type, you can see that it is like a flooding or unicast, multicast, broadcast. It here, it is just like a first broadcast, then unicast, and then multicast. Now in this case, it is a broadcast, then unicast, and a multicast. Because first it will broadcast, and then once everybody is ready to access, then only it will follow. Device type, here it is not an intelligent. This is an intelligent device, and this is an intelligent device. Router and switch both are intelligent. This is used for the LAN. Here it is used for LAN, metropolitan area network, and wide area network. Transmission mode, this is a half duplex. Here it is half and full duplex. This is a full duplex. Coming to the speed, it is only 10 Mbps. This is 10 to 100 and 1 Gbps, and it is more than 100 Mbps and up to 1 Gbps in the wired and 100 Mbps plus in the wireless. And the data transmission in this case, MAC address, and here it is IP address. So this is what we seen with respect to the hub switches and router. Now we finally see across the discussion on IPv4 and IPv6 before we conclude. We have seen in the network layer as a whole, it was talking about the network and devices and finally the addresses. Now here if you take about the IPv4 address, it is a 32-bit address. 32-bit means it is having a 4-byte each, 4 bytes, 4 bytes. So 4 bytes means 4 into 8, that is 32. That means there are 4 groups of 8 bits each. Now in this case it is 128 bits, and that 128 bits is nothing but 16 into 8. So there are 8 groups of 16 bytes each, hex forms. Packet size, you can see that 576 are required for fragmentation optional. Now here it is 1280 bytes. It is without fragmentation. Packet fragmentations here, it means the router and the sending host. Now here the sending host only. Packet header, it does not identify the packet flow for quality of standard handling. If you look across the packet header, because it is looking for the destinations, it includes the checksum and another options. There are different other options up to 40 bytes. Whereas if you try to see here, it contains a flow level, so that's why the packet will try to maintain a quality of standards. And but here it does not have a checksum, and extension header is a optional in this case, whereas here it is the header is mandatory. Domain name service DNS is nothing but in this case address records the maps of the host name, and the pointer records in address ARPA DNS domain, etc. Here if you look across the same pointer, PRT address is there, and IP6 ARPA we have discussed, and the DNS domain. Next is address configurations. This is a manual or via DHCP, and here it is seamless or a stateless address. In this case we have discussed about this one also. IP of a MAC resolution, this is a broadcast ARP. Here it is in place of broadcast, it is a multicast condition it follows. Local group subnet management, in this case IGMP it is followed. Here it is a multicast because a large number of address is there. Broadcast is yes, here it is no. Multicast, this also applies for the multicast, and this is already there. IP sequence, IP security, it is optional and external. This is in this case it is required. So these are nothing but the different configurations within the IPv4 and IPv6. So let me summarize that we have discussed here the network access layer protocols and its functionals. Then we discuss about the classless inter-domain routing, followed by address resolution protocol ARP to identify the host, the client device. And then we studied about the RARP, that is a reverse address resolution protocol, from the host to find the from the client to find the host IP, or we can say that host like to find the IP, whereas in the RARP, that is in the RARP and the ARP, it is to find the and the client it is client physical address or the MAC address. After that we discuss about ICMP, then we discussed about the IGMP with respect to the various network, and virtual LAN followed by network devices. Then we have seen the hub, switch and router, and finally we discussed the IPv4 and IPv6. So with this we conclude the network device. Thank you.